and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. A Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it?
Good morning. Welcome to Terrace Park. We're thankful that you're here. We're thankful that you've been able to join us today. It's a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord, and we're so thankful that we have a place to worship. We're so thankful that for those that are online, that they have an opportunity to share with us in worship. Who would have ever thought that we would be in a situation like this, but we're thankful for the ability to do what God has asked us to do in any way He asks. You know, Paul writes about that in the epistles. He says, I will do whatever it takes if one more person can hear the gospel. And I believe that with all my heart and all my soul, is that that is a call to the church to say, you know, whatever it takes for us to share the good news with just one more person. That's what should drive us to be at the Lord's work, to do what He has commanded us to do. I'm thankful that you're here, and I'm thankful that we have the ability on Tuesday nights to have Bible study. I hope that you're able to join. We're still in Galatians this week, but starting next week, we're going to start the book of Matthew. Now, we've never done Matthew while I've been here, so we're going to go. It's going to take us some time, but we're going to go through the book of Matthew, and I really think there'll be some real insight that we'll draw from Matthew. Wednesday night is prayer meeting. We get a lot of attendance online for that because we are online still only, and we're thankful that we have a way to do that. I think last week we had 13 or 14 people at prayer meeting. And then as always, I just wanted to remind you, you know, you guys are doing amazing things when it comes to supporting this ministry financially. And I just wanted to make sure you understood how you could do that. Here we don't take an offering anymore. We currently have it where you just drop it in the back. You can mail it in, which we received one this week. From one of my uncles who will remain nameless. I don't want to embarrass him, but he just wanted to support the church, and I'm thankful for that. If he's listening, I just wanted to say thank you. And then also you can get online and you can use the electronic method of tithing. We're doing better than most churches when it comes to our tithe. And I believe the board meets this Thursday and we'll be looking at the budget, but I think we're pretty much dead on our budget. We're not off by a lot. So I'm thankful for that. That tells you your heart, where your heart is where, you know, where you put your money is where your heart is. And I believe, you know, when we are willing to say the ministry of God is important to me, then great things can happen. And so we're getting ready to worship, but I'd like to just open us up with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, come near us right now. Come together with us and hear our praises to you. Lighten our hearts as we praise you. May we worship you in such a way that you know that we believe that you are the one and only God, that you are the one that is everything to us, that you are the impetus to all blessings. You are the impetus to all good. And we raise our voices to you right now, praising you for who you are. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you stand, please?
and I will live for you.
Sometimes it's moments of brokenness which create the greatest transformations. Times where fear gives birth to faith, pain leads to healing, and chaos dissolves into peace. It's in these times we often see God more clearly. For in our deepest turmoil, He remains faithful. When our spirit is crushed, He remains strong. When our moment is too heavy, He carries the burden. As gold is refined by fire, we too are often refined by struggle. It's part of growing, changing, becoming. Lately, the journey has been difficult. Our breath has been labored. Our steps uneasy. But we stand in faith, knowing who is leading us through this desert. The God of peace, the God of hope, the God of restoration.
We come to the time of the service where we worship in prayer. You know, I was looking at that video, and last Sunday I was in a conference. It's called the One Church, and we meet down in Crown Point. And I met a pastor that I have not met before, but he knew Pastor Bryant very well, and he's from the New Hope Baptist Church in Hammond. And we were talking for a little bit, and what he said was that thrilled me in some ways. He said that until we get uncomfortable as a church, and he meant a global church, obviously, we'll never change. And I think about prayer a little bit, and I think about, you know, what are we praying for? Are we asking for comfort all the time? Are we asking for everything being perfect, that there's nothing that ever, like, motivates us to move or motivates us to change? But this African-American man said that I'm thankful we're uncomfortable, because perhaps there will be godly change in us. I will suggest to you that if you're always comfortable in your Christianity, in your spirituality, if you're always comfortable, that perhaps you don't pray as much because you feel like you don't need it. But I will tell you right now that God has created this communication with Him so that when we are uncomfortable, we have somebody to talk to that is greater than us. It's great to have a spouse. It's great to have friends. It's great to have moms and dads. It's great to have grandparents that can tell you, that you can speak to them on what is truth. But the reality of it is that God has given you a direct communication line to Him. That when you are struggling, when you are needing Him, when you need to talk to somebody, God, who created you, gave you a way to speak to Him. If that does not thrill you, if that does not drive you to worship, the God that created beautiful butterflies, wondrous mountains, the complexity of our thumb, that God has given you a method to speak to Him. What a wonderful opportunity it is when we get to speak to Him. And when we start to think through what it means to come together at this point in the service, to set aside a time when we celebrate and we worship Him for that opportunity to pray, I hope we come with some humility. I hope that we come with some excitement and anticipation. Do you believe that God has prepared a way for us that is beyond any imagination that you have right now? Do you believe that God cares more about what's good in your life, that He has plans for you that are good and not evil? That is why we pray. That is why we hope. That is why we trust. That is why that when we take the time to talk about prayer, not only today but also on Wednesday nights, it's because this pastor believes that prayer is the fuel to a healthy church. You can eat a bunch of junk food spiritually. You can do, you know, you can eat blueberry pie and all kinds of stuff, but you need your spinach. A church needs spinach. It needs nutrients. And one of the key nutrients of a church is when it is fueled by prayer. When people are willing to humble themselves before the Lord and speak to Him. A church, whether we're talking about Terrace Park or whether we're talking about a global church, if it is not willing to humble themselves before God and speak to Him, will starve to death. If you are online, we have the ability for you to write down prayer requests. And so if you write them in the comment field, I look at them later and I pray over them. One I got today that I will be putting out as a prayer request is Jeff Ron, who most of us know, is going back to New York for another heart procedure. So keep him in your prayers. I don't know any more details than that, but I do know that he needs our prayers. We've prayed for him often, and God has answered him. That's the great part about God, is that, you know, He promised us that He'll hear him. And what I'm thankful for is that I've seen it over and over again where He hears our prayers. So if you have a prayer request, you can write them down like Joan did, or would you just be willing to raise your hand and say, I've got a prayer request on my heart. A lot of hands went up. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to You right now. Lord, we come to You with expectant hearts because You have built that expectation into our lives. You have told us that if we pray that You will hear us, that You will listen to us, that You were there. You know, one of the big questions for many people is, God hearing my prayers? And I emphatically say yes, because I believe in Your promises. I trust in you. I rely upon you. And when the worst comes or when the best comes, you are always there. And Lord, right now, for those in need, those are struggling. We know that Scott's family is dealing with all kinds of stuff right now. His dad's surgery, his uncle passing away, you know, and all those things that are going on in their lives. May they trust in you more. May they find you as their comfort. And Lord, for Jeff, will you give him that healing power that only you can provide? Even just your name heals. Just speaking your name heals, and we're so thankful for that. And for all those that we have been praying for right now, we ask, Lord, that you come near them. May they feel your presence. May they know that you are a real God. May they know you're the solution to everything. May they know that you love them and you care for them and that you wish the best for them. May you come near them right now and may they sense your presence. Lord, we want to thank you for all that you have done, all that you are about to do, and we anticipate what you are going to do, Lord. And Lord, we're so excited to see that. We're so excited right now to know all the great things that you are about to do. And we thank you for that. Let us all say together, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And they all said, amen.
Listen.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. 'Cause nothing else could take your place to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way, bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all I ever needed. You're all. No one else will do. 'Cause nothing else could take your place to feel the warmth of your embrace.
Everyone,
help me find the way.
bring me back to you.
Leviticus 19, 33 and 34. When an alien lives with you in your land, do not mistreat him. The alien living with you must be treated as one of your native born. Love him as yourself, for you were aliens in Egypt. I am the Lord your God.
Amen. You can be seated. I have some good news. Perhaps is a statement that creates or elicits joy or happiness. I have some great news is often something that we need right now. You know, like it seems like every time we turn, there's some type of news that isn't what we want to hear. I have great news. Way too often when I talk about the hospital-like church, I'm afraid that we hear that and we think of illness and we think of brokenness and we think of struggle and we think of the difficulties of life and we never get to the point where we can say, I have good news. Part of the hospital moment in our physical hospitals is the moment that they come in, at least for me, it always has been, I have good news. You get to go home. Because most of us hate being there, right? Most of us struggle being there, but we love the fact that when we are healed and when we have that okay by the physician to say it is okay to go home. I have good news. Never think that when I have been talking about this hospital-like church, it's all about being, you know, down and out and everything is horrible. A hospital church should be celebrating. I know, like in a hospital, one of the cool things that many of them do now is that you'll hear some kind of music every time a baby is born. And it'll ring out through the whole hospital, not just in the maternity ward, but everywhere. And you'll hear it and you'll go, oh, we have good news. And I, you know, I think way too often as a church, maybe we don't hear that music. We don't hear that hope. We don't hear that joy. And perhaps way too often we don't speak of, I have good news. I have good news. But know this, that where the Lord is, there is always good news. Where the Lord is, there is always good news. And whether you are brokenhearted, whether you are struggling with something, whether you feel isolated, whether you have been beaten down, whether you, whatever is going on in your life, if Jesus is in the center of your life, there is good news. It may not always feel good, but there is always good news when the Lord is around. And I wrote this morning in my notes, and I wanted to read it. When applied freely, good news is a fresh breeze on a spring morning, bringing promises of new beginnings. Let me say that again. Good news is like an early spring breeze. You remember one of those? It has so much promise in it, right? It's warming up. It may not be warm yet, but it's warming up. There's a promise there. There's a hope there. There's this new beginning. And that is the good news. That the Lord has provided for us a breath of fresh air. A good news that we can live by, that we can hope by, that we can be joyful of. Isaiah writes in chapter 61, verse 11, "For as the earth brings forth its bud, as the garden causes the things that are sown in it to spring forth, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations." You see, this new beginning caused by the breathing of good news, the wind of good news. What it brings is these flowers and these blossoms and these fruits of righteousness. Now, what does a righteous fruit look like? What does a righteous blossom look like? What flower blooms out of righteousness? And I will tell you that God's will in our lives changes our lives in such a way that it's not chaotic anymore. Does your life feel chaotic? Pray for more righteousness. Pray for what's right to God. Pray that God's will is in your life, because when the good news shares God's will and the good news becomes God's will, our lives are less chaotic. You see, way too often you'll hear people say, "Well, my life's so hectic, I don't got time for God. I don't got time for Jesus. It's just too hectic." When it calms down, I'll get right with the Lord then. I'm going to tell you a little secret. I'm going to tell you a little story. When I worked at Xerox, he was a great Christian man. He still is. His name was Bill. He was the only guy that I worked under. He was my boss. And we would get, we were running 60, 70 hours a week, him and I. And I used to always say to him, "Well, I'll get to that when everything calms down." And he would, he'd say, "Okay." Finally, one day he came in my office and he asked me something. I said, "Well, I'll get to that when everything calms down." He said, "Look, Scott, it's never going to calm down. Let's just start going forward." And I learned so much from that. And I'll take the spiritual side of that to this point. Is that don't expect the chaos to stop without Jesus being there in your life. Go forward in Him and the chaos will move. Because you have moved, not because of the chaos. God is expecting us to move. That is how we blossom. That is how we flower. That is how we fruit. The good news creates a yearning in us that when we deny it, it causes all kinds of dryness. You know, like dry land yearns for rain. Now, just a couple weeks ago, it's not that way now, but my yard was cracking because it was so dry. I don't think it was that way 10 minutes away up here, but in my yard, it was actually, there were cracks running through the yard because it yearned for rain. The same is true for us. Our soul yearns for God, yearns for His good news, yearns for His love. And if we are not seeking that, if we're not pushing toward that, if we're not looking for His love, if we're not praying toward it, we can dry up. We can there can be cracks that get in our lives because we are dry. We must always yearn for the good news. The psalmist writes in chapter 130, verse 5 to 7, I wait for the Lord, my soul waits. And his words, I do hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch for the morning. Yes, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is mercy, and with him is abundant redemption. The psalmist describes this anticipation of the good news. Have you ever anticipated good news and it just seemed like it just like hung on the edge and it wasn't there? I think I've said this many a times, but I was horrible as a kid with Christmas. I was like, is he here yet? Is he here yet? Is he here yet? And I remember at one point my dad worked nights and he worked 3 to 11s and he had just got home and it was like 2 o'clock in the morning. I said, I hear him out there. We got to get up. And so my loving dad and mother, who probably weren't really that loving at that moment, got up and opened the Christmas presents that were under the tree. But I anticipated the good news. Is your heart anticipating God's good news? Is your heart yearning for His good news? You see, His good news comes from the Word of God. And if you want to know what His good news is, it's right here. All you have to do is crack it open. Or, you know, for some of us now, it's hit the app and open it, right? I don't care how you get the Bible in you, get the Bible in you. Because it will change you, because you will hear these redemptive promises. God can make a new reality out of a dark situation. Praise the Lord. How many of us have been in a dark situation and God changed the reality of your life? Secondly, the impossible will someday be the possible. Whatever seems like there is no way this could ever happen, it can. Third, our current situation of despair will in the future turn into unspeakable joy. Do you believe that? Do you believe that you can have unspeakable joy? No matter what your past is, remember, with God, your past never dictates your future. It is one of the wonders of the good news. It is one of the powers of the good news, is that your past does not dictate your future. And if we were a holy rolling church right now, we'd probably be running up and down the aisles, because many of us, if our past dictated our future, would be in a sorry state right now. But praise be to God that our past does not dictate our future, and that is good news. We should be excited about that. And no matter where you are, no matter your current circumstances, God can lead you out of the shadows into the sunshine of His love. We're going to read about a gentleman today that he received the good news. And he went from the shadows of death to the sunshine of Christ. If you have your Bibles with you, if you'll open them up to Mark chapter 5. I tried to figure out how to do this. This is over 20 verses, so I'm going to do a little bit of summarizing so that we can get to the verses that I really want to work with today, and I'll try to do a summary that is true to the Scripture. So there's this man that Jesus encounters. Interesting, again, he's a Gentile. Remember, Gentiles back then were outsiders. Right? They were people that were not part of the religious group. We are the Gentiles today unless somebody has a Jewish heritage. But back then, he was a Gentile and he was considered an outsider to the people that Jesus was walking with. He was considered an outsider. And he was living in a country of Gadarenes. I don't know if I pronounced that correctly. It is in the area where the tribe of Gad was, on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. But I use the word living loosely, because he lived in tombs with the stench of death all around him. And because of this stench of death and the tombs that he lived in, people avoided him. The man was also possessed by many demons. In fact, later in the chapter, we will hear the demons name themselves as Legion. Now, we don't know what that number means. It's a lot. A legion in the Roman Empire army was between 4,000 and 6,000 men. So I don't know if when Luke writes this, is he saying he has 4,000 to 6,000 demons within him? I don't know. All I can tell you is he was a troubled man. He was so troubled, his life was so chaotic that it says that he was constantly crying out and cutting himself with stones. Look, one of the things about Satan is, and his minion, is that he wishes to destroy. He wishes to destroy. And this man was destroying himself and destroying everything around him. They tried to bind him up to try to help him from not hurting himself. They tried to put him in chains. They tried to imprison him. And he was so manically strong, they couldn't stop it. They couldn't stop him. He would just rip through the chains. But the destruction that Satan wishes to do in our lives is very similar. He cares less how much he hurts you and people around you. He doesn't care about that. He doesn't care if you're crying out in pain. All he cares about is that he destroys you. And he's destroying this man. This man has no place to stay. The man doesn't have any way to get away from the stench of death. And I will tell you today, there are so many people out in this world that are not demon possessed, that live in the stench of death. And yet there is the good news. It's amazing, and you get hints of this in the scripture, and I imagine it's probably true, is that the townspeople had given up on him. They had tried, and they said, well, there ain't nothing we can do about it. And what is even probably more indicting or more horrible is that he had given up on himself. Could you imagine not to be able to control yourself to the point where you're destroying yourself? Well, some of you can. I could. There was a time in my life where I was trying to destroy myself. I don't call it demon possession, but it is the allowing the liar to whisper into your heart that you're not good enough. How could God love you? This man was desperate and he had given up. See, the good news says there's reasons not to give up. When we celebrate the good news, we must recognize that there's hope for each of us, no matter how good you are or how horrible you are. You see, I think it's one of the key points of understanding what Jesus came to this earth. Part of the good news was this: there is not enough moralizing in your life that will create redemption or salvation. It only comes from Jesus Christ. And praise be to God, it only comes from Him, because none of us could be moral enough to satisfy the righteousness of God. This man was struggling so much that they had cast him into the tomb area and tried to just sort of hem him in there. Satan will try to do the same with you. Satan will try to isolate you, put you in a place of death, and convince you that you have no answer, no way out, that this prison that he wishes to build, you cannot break out of, and he tries to convince you that, but it's a lie. The good news tells us that it's a lie. Mark 5, 6, it says, "And when he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and worshiped him." Now, I don't know here if this is the man or if this is Legion. Both could be true. The man could be fighting all his instincts, everything that's going on in his life, and somehow he musters up enough to get in front of Jesus. Have you ever felt that way? If you ever felt like, man, if I could just crawl to him, if I could belly crawl to him, he is the solution. Something could happen that was good if I could just get there. Or maybe it was Legion, because it says even the demons knew who Jesus was. And it goes on to say, "And he cried out with a loud voice and said, 'What have I to do with you, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I implore you by God that you do not torment me.'" Legion knew God's capability. He knew Jesus' capability. Do you know his capability? He goes on and says, "For he said to him," he being Jesus, "'Come out of the man, unclean spirit.' Then he asked him, 'What is your name?' And he answered, saying, 'My name is Legion, for we are many.'" So Jesus commands Legion to come out of this man. And when Jesus commands him, Legion has to respond. So Legion, and we're not going to read this part of the scripture, but Legion says, well, hey, could you not like throw us away somewhere? Could you put us somewhere? And Jesus says, sure, I'll put you in these 2,000 pigs over here. And the Legion goes into the pigs. They go crazy. They can't handle it. And they run and drown themselves. So those that witnessed this just couldn't believe what just happened. This Jesus just takes these demons, this legion, and puts them in pigs, and they run off. And they go tell the townspeople and the owners of the pigs what had happened. And they come to see. Now hear this in verse 15, I'm sorry. Then they came to Jesus and saw the one who had been demon-possessed and had the legion sitting and clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. I want you to think about this for a minute. Have you seen that kind of transformation before by the good news? This man was chaotic. This man was trying to destroy himself. This man was over the top, screaming all the time, walking through the stench of death. And these townspeople come out who had given up on him and said, there's no chance for you. These townspeople come. And he's sitting there clothed. For one thing, it sounds like he was naked all the time. You know, like he was always running around naked, and all at once he's got clothes on. I think the reason that the clothes was important was to show that, you know, he had sort of come back to normal civilization. And he was in his right mind. He had got to the point where he could talk, because it was him and not Legion speaking for him. You see, when God redeems you, when the good news happens in your life, when the light starts to drive away the darkness, you become your true self again. What you think is yourself is not you. God designed you to be righteous. God designed you to have a relationship with Him. And when we are in our right mind, our righteous mind, people will notice. It's a miraculous moment. But as we read the story, what we're going to find out is the townspeople are not happy about it. They're not happy at all. And I will tell you this, that when you finally get in your righteous mind, there will be people that will try to tear you down because of that. There'll be people that say, oh, you're a Christian, huh? You know, 30 years ago, you were applauded for being a Christian, even if the other person wasn't. Today, you better be ready for somebody to say, oh, you're a Christian, you're one of those. You see, that's how the townspeople treated him. Well, how could you be anything more than you were? How can we accept you? I mean, are you going to come back to town now and act like nothing ever happened? See, what Satan always does, he did this to Eve. He did this to Adam. He'll do it to you if you don't watch it. You got to be guarded against this. He'll say, well, is this going to hurt you? Is this really something that's bad for you? Then as soon as you do it, what he'll end up saying is, oh, look at you, you dirty little sinner. Wait, I better not point at anybody. Sorry about the pointy finger. But, you know, he says, look what you just did. You're horrible. That's how he tries to start imprisoning you, saying, you know, you're so horrible. And these townspeople could not accept the fact that this man had met Jesus and that the good news changed his life. You know, I will say this. There's a lot of attributes of Satan that are deplorable. And this one's not necessarily a good one, but we would attribute it to a human being as a good one. He's not a quitter. I mean, he's been defeated since the cross and he's still fighting. When he thinks that he still has an opportunity to attack you, he will attack. You know, here's what they say. This is in verse 17. Then they begin to plead with him to depart from their region. They told Jesus to leave after this great miracle. Surely they had looked at this guy and said, it's impossible that this man will be anything else than what he is. It is impossible. And yet, when they see it happen with their own eyes, what do? They ask him to leave. Jesus, you're going to have to leave. We can't handle this. So Satan is starting to whisper in their ears, what was it about? Well, hey, you hurt us financially. We were going to make money off those pigs. Why'd you have to kill the pigs? Surely that guy's soul was not more valuable than 2,000 pigs. Church, we got to be careful. We got to be careful with this attitude. I don't think we have it here, but I think we got to always be praying about it. We always have to say that this person is worth every effort we have for them to find Jesus. If it meant that we spent every penny, if it meant that we had nothing, if our health started to fail, it'd be worth it if one more person could find the good news. That may seem radical to you until you start to recognize what it is like to live in the stench of death. Do you think this guy would ever want to go back to the tombs and live in the stench of death again? Do you think that he wishes that he would lose all control and his life would go back to be chaotic? I don't. Do you? Why would he? You see, the fear, you know, I like that song where it says, fear is a liar. See, when Satan can whisper fear into people's lives, he can paralyze them if they listen. And this townspeople, instead of continuing to get the blessings of Jesus, continue to like thrive in what with Jesus being there, they run him off. And what we have to be careful as Christians that we're not running off Jesus, that we're always inviting him in, that he always is the center of everything we do. That it's not about moralizing. It's about centering on him and allowing him to make us righteous. We'll end up being moral because of Jesus, not because of us. This man was healed, not because of him, but because he was confronted, made uncomfortable. Please don't torment me, God. And he was redeemed. He was cured. He was changed. His past no longer his future. Goes on in 18 and says, and when he got into the boat, he being Jesus, he who had been demon-possessed begged him that he might be with him. You see, he doesn't want to ever leave Jesus. He's like, okay, Wherever you go, I'm going to follow. We sing that song, right? That's a hymn, isn't it? Wherever you go, I will follow, right? I mean, that's a song we sing. Could you imagine if Jesus had just taken out Legion? How much you would want to follow. It goes on in 19. However, Jesus did not permit him, but said to him, now hear this, go home to your friends and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you and how he has had compassion on you. And he departed and began to proclaim to the Decapolis, all that Jesus had done for him, and all marveled. Isaiah 49:13 reads, sing, O heavens, be joyful, O earth, and break out in singing, O mountains, for the Lord has confronted his people, comforted his people, and will have mercy on his afflicted. Jesus says, go. Go tell your friends about this. Go tell the townspeople about this. Go tell everybody that wants to listen about this. Let them know. You know, it's interesting. Before this, Jesus had never said to somebody, go tell them what happened. But this man, he tells, because he knows he's not going to be back in that area. You know, start spreading the good news. Spread the good news. Go and do it because they need to hear what happened in your life. You can't be walking with me at this moment because I need you to be on mission, that is, spreading the good news. So what is the good news? Well, I mean, in essence, it's Jesus. In essence, it's Jesus. If you wanted to be a little bit more verbose about it, it is this. God loved you so much, he sent his son to die on a cross for you. Who rose again on 3 days, defeating death. And is up in heaven right now, speaking to the Father on your behalf. And if you believe, you will inherit eternal life. The good news is that God loved you so much that he created a plan for you to repair your relationship with him. Have you ever said, I have good news, and really have the good news? I have good news. My Father loves me. My Lord walks with me. The Spirit guides me. If you don't know the good news, if for some reason your life is in a place where it's chaotic and you're saying, well, what do I do now, Lord? Well, how do I change, Lord? What's new? What's different? What is it even possible? Run to Jesus. Run to him right now. He can change everything. He is the solution to all things. You want peace in your life? You want your chaotic life to be changed? Run to Jesus. You want your love to defeat hate? Run to Jesus. Run to him now. Don't wait another second. Don't wait till you think you're able. Crawl to Him. Belly crawl to Him. Whatever you got to do. Have somebody drag you to Him. Drop you from the ceiling. Whatever it takes. Find the good news of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to You. And we come to You with rejoicing hearts because we have seen the good news. In many of our lives right now, Lord, we are so flabbergasted with all that You have done. How You have taken our past and made it into such a bright future. When it seemed impossible, You made it possible. When it was the darkest, You shed light. When we were the thirstiest, You gave us drink. When we were the hungriest, You fed us. And when we doubted ourselves the most, when we even hated ourselves, You loved us. Help us push aside the fear of the liar. Help us push aside the lies of shame, fear, and guilt. Help us do a better job of denying the liar from speaking into our hearts by filling our hearts with Your love, with Your word, and with Your spirit. Come near us right now if there's someone out there that doesn't know You, doesn't know Your good news. Come near them and may they feel Your presence right now. May they know that You are the one and only God, that You are a God of great possibilities. Touch their hearts right now, Lord. Convict them into reaching for You. May they repent to You today. May they know that You are a loving God. May we go and tell others, I have good news. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.